heart rise. You feel helpless and you're looking to the sky. Some people would say to accept defeat. Well, if this is fate, then we'll find a way to cheat. 'Cause oh, 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 we'll say a little breath. The door, oh, 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 if the answer isn't fair. No, you can call on me. From falling down. If the answer isn't fair, then call on me.
Call on me
when you need somebody.
Call on me
when you can't stop the tears from falling down.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back. For those of you who may not have been able to join us earlier for the Experienceship Participant Orientation, allow me to introduce myself again. My name is Katherine Robinson, and I lead our programs team here at Step Up, and I'm honored to welcome you to our special edition of Ask Me Anything for all of our Experienceship participants. I'd like to kick off this event by taking a moment to acknowledge and thank y'all for joining us today. I'd also like to recognize all of those that are experiencing Step Up for the first time today. Welcome. Everyone, give us a hello. Tell us where you're from in the chat. We look forward to getting to know you. So let's see in the chat, has anybody new joined us? Elaine from Toronto. Maria, New York, LA, Massachusetts, Sophia. Nafisa from Texas, Irving, Texas. Holly in Louisiana. Let's see, Atlanta, Georgia, all over. All right, well, before we officially get started, I'd love to share a few friendly reminders. First off, we're asking that everyone take a moment and adjust their display name to reflect three things: your name, your role, and the pronouns you use. You can look at the screen and see what I mean. We'd love to ask that everyone who's able to turn on your camera to do so, please. Even though we're not physically in person, we'd love to create that feeling, and it supports us in creating an intimate, safe, and brave space for everyone. This is also good practice for your experienceship, remember that. Finally, all participants' mics will be on mute until we go into our breakout session, so feel free to add your positive comments and reactions in the chat box at the bottom of your screen. Additionally, if you need support with anything at all throughout the event, please feel free to message Susie, staff, she in the chat. All right. So let's take a look at our objectives for today. What are we doing in this session? We are going to introduce the concept of social capital and the importance of personal and professional connections in our lives. Understand common barriers to building career connections and learn strategies to build and maintain your connections. And examine your personal network of career connections to determine where you may need to add to it. All right. So that is our agenda. Now we're going to kick things off with, here's today's agenda. I'm sorry. We're going to kick things off with an icebreaker. Then I'm going to introduce our special guest, Maggie Lopez, who is a Step Up alumna who now works as Diversity and Inclusion Talent Management Specialist with the law firm Shepherd Mullin. She's going to give a presentation on how to build social capital during your upcoming experienceships and beyond. And then we'll break out into our breakout rooms for a skill building activity, and then come back together for some group share outs and reflections. Lastly, we'll close out with some poll questions, announcements, reminders, and all that. So let's get going into our icebreaker activity. So who's on your island? So imagine that you are stuck on a desert island that you actually want to get off of. You don't want to just stay there. You want to get off of it. And only three other people are on the island with you. We've got a list of 12 different people there. Which of these people would you want with you and why? Remember, you can only pick three. So put your name, put their names and your reason for picking them in the chat. Which of three of these would you want with you? Let's see, I'll go ahead and read through because I know y'all are probably reading, trying to, and let me just say, these are all real people. So we've got Mukesh Ambani, who's a billionaire, Dr. Adeep Pant, who is an oceanographer, Anthony Mackie, who's an actor, Michelle Wu, who's the mayor of Boston, Rihanna, entertainer and entrepreneur, Bear Grylls, who's an adventurer and TV host, Dinah Griffin, who's an architect, Laura Decker, who's a sailor, Marcus Samuelson, who's a chef, and I'm trying to see it, Elisa Bonnelly, who's a marine biologist, Bill Nye, the science guy, and Deb Haaland, who's the U.S. Secretary of the Interior. Which of those three? Let's see. All right, let's see what we've got. We've got a few rolling in. We've got Anthony Mackie, Aditi Pant, and Laura Decker, Chelsea. Curious why? Rihanna, because why not? It's Rihanna. Mukesh Ambani, Michelle Wu, and Bill Nye. Pratika, I'm curious why. Tell us why. Let's see who else. Dr. Aditi Pant, Bear Grylls, and Bill Nye, says Charnay. Nafisa says Rihanna, the sailor and the marine biologist. I wonder why. All right, who is willing to take themselves off of mute and just tell us your three and kind of give us a reason why? Let's see if we can get one or two folks to share out loud.
I could.
All right, go ahead.
I already sent it on the chat, but I can say it out loud. Rihanna, because I love her music, and with no matter where I am, I'm gonna need some music, honestly. And Anthony Mackie, because he would make the mood like more nice. I think like if we are all desperate, he would make us laugh no matter the situation.
Okay.
And lastly, but not least, Bear Grylls, because I don't know him that much, but we need someone to keep us alive. So.
Very good. Very good. She has a strategy behind who she's picking. Awesome. Anybody else?
I put Mukesh Ambani because, like, you know, he could give like tips on like how to be money smart, you know, how to like build your capital and stuff. So it would be good for like the future when you grow up. And then Michelle Wu, because like, I don't know, I could get like, you know, I'm into like politics, so it'd be like cool to hear about like how she got started on her career. So like, it'd get like, if we're stuck on an island, we could just have like a mentoring networking session. And then I picked Bill Nye, the science guy, because I like science, so it'd be cool to like, because I know his videos are always like really interactive and like cool to watch, so I could like ask him about his knowledge. And then I know he said three, but when I talked about like, you know, you need someone to keep you alive on the island, then maybe the chef we could like take him to, because he could make us food.
Awesome. Great. Love the strategy there. Love that good strategic thinking. All right. So I'm seeing some really cool ones in the chat. A lot of you are very strategic in who you chose to remain with you on the island. So that is very smart. All right. So thank you to everybody for participating in our icebreaker. All the combinations are so interesting. I find it very interesting. A lot of you just like Rihanna. Let's you know, maybe she could just sing for us. We love her for the music. So all the combinations are interesting. Y'all had a lot of smart thinking about building your team to help you get off that island, or just, you know, make the time on the island pass by well. So trust me, this line of thinking and assessing who you'll put on your team will come in handy as we continue with this session. Now, I am so excited to introduce our special guest today, Maggie Lopez, Diversity and Inclusion and Talent Management Specialist at Shepherd Mullin, an international law firm with over 1,000 attorneys located in North America, Europe, and Asia. At Shepherd Mullin, Maggie focuses on supporting the firm-wide diversity and inclusion initiatives across 11 offices around the United States. She creates programming and leads groups for attorneys who identify as women, Black, Indigenous, or people of color, and a part of the LGBTQ community. Maggie was born and raised in Koreatown in Los Angeles, California. She's the proud daughter of immigrants from Guatemala and Honduras. Maggie earned her degree in sociology and Latinx studies at Vassar College, located in New York. And for almost the past decade, she has worked in education, learning and development, and diversity, equity, and inclusion. Maggie joined Step Up when she was in seventh grade. And as an alumna of the program, she experienced the support system Step Up offers. It's amazing, right? Think about it. This could be you in several years. So everybody, please join me in welcoming our guest mentor, Maggie Lopez. Maggie, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you for that introduction. I'm so excited to be in community with you all. Like Catherine said, Step Up is very near and dear to my heart. When I think about it, I've been a part of this network for so long, and it's been such an incredible journey to be a student, be an alumna, go to events, and like I said, do something like this today. So like Catherine mentioned, we're going to be talking all about social capital, and maybe something, a term that you've heard about before, maybe it's new to you, but we're going to dive deep into what it is, maybe some barriers to how we're gaining social capital, and then give you some tips on how to actually maintain and build these networks, right? Like we talked about the deserted island, y'all had some really amazing strategies of why you chose the folks that you did. And in particular, as you're preparing for your experienceship next week, it's really important for us to have top of mind this idea of networking, right? Like Step Up Women's Network, there's a reason why it's called that. So let's get right into it. But before we go to the next slide, I would love for you all in the chat to put what you think social capital means. So if you can, if you know, that's great to put in your own words, but if you want to take a guess, what does social capital means? And break up the word, right? When we think about capital, what does capital mean? And in combination with social. So put it in the chat. What do you think social capital means? And I like to say there are no wrong answers, there are only creative answers. So please take your best guess. Don't be shy. The people you work with, thank you, Issa, right? So people around you, when we think about social capital, we think about that. And maybe if you don't have a definition, that's fine, but anything that kind of relates to it, words that you think about when you think about social capital. So maybe social capital, social reputation, or how much social capital you've earned in your social life, right? So thinking about earning or thinking about capital, that's a really great way to think about it. Any other associations that you think about when you see this term? The connections you have with the people around you. Yes, thank you for sharing that. basically saying your network is your net worth. I love that. Yes, we should probably like put that somewhere because that's a really good saying. Thank you. Awesome. All right. So now that you all shared what you think it means, associations that you have with it, let's look at the definition that we crafted together. So if we can go to the next slide. Awesome. So as you see here, social capital is a network or relationships, right? Or connections that you make that serve as a resource or a support system for you as you're moving along your life, your social life, your career and whatnot. So I like to think about social capital as a way that allows you to kind of leverage relationships, leverage connections to gain knowledge, to gain resources, or to gain opportunities, and hopefully in a mutually beneficial way, right? So like if you're helping someone out, they're also helping you out. Essentially, like we hope that, you know, you are kind of taking social capital into importance because it's a way for you to connect people in a way that's going to open doors for you. Because oftentimes, I'm going to speak for myself, it's really comfortable for me to connect with people that I either know or people that, you know, folks have connected me to. But have you ever, if you've ever been to like a networking experience, right, where you're in a room full of strangers, it's really hard, again, speaking for myself, to like go up to a stranger and introduce yourself, right? And so we'll talk about barriers in a little bit. But as you're looking at this definition, any questions that you have about how we are defining social capital? No, I'm going to ask you for questions along the way. So at any point, if I'm talking too much or if I'm not making sense, please put any questions in the chat, but we'll also have some space for a Q&A in a little bit. All right. So again, when we're thinking about social capital, we're thinking about a network of relationships, right? A network of people that you're either meeting along the way, and social capital really is a way for you to develop these connections again, and then you can kind of reap the benefits of having as many people on your team, right? When we think about that. And at Step Up, there is a core value that reads like respectful relationships, right? And that's a way for you to build relationships in a respectful manner. You don't want to ask strangers for help if you're not building a relationship with them, right? Because people are going to want to help folks that they are either connected to or that they trust. They're not going to want to help someone that's just there because they want to gain something from them, right? So it's important for us to build relationships first before we're asking for help. And then when we think about our careers, even if you're just starting a career or if you're, you know, a young teen right now, so many people, when you ask, personally, when I ask anyone how they gained their employment or how they were able to get in the industry that they were able to get into, it's because of someone that they knew. There's a study that says that about 7% of jobs are not actually publicly published. So when you're looking for jobs, if you're looking on LinkedIn, you're looking on Idealist, all these websites, so many jobs aren't actually public to people that aren't in the know-how, right? So I know personally for me, the first couple of jobs that I got, the first internship I got was because of Step Up. And the first couple of jobs that I gained was because I knew someone that knew someone, right? So it's so much easier to kind of get your foot in the door when you have this connection with someone or you know someone that knows someone. So I would love for you all to kind of share with me in your life, wherever you are now, how have you benefited from social capital or a connection? Or if how you see yourself benefiting from making these networks, connecting with folks in the future. Thank you, Susie. Susie put the question in the chat as well. How have you benefited so far, either from, you know, getting an internship or getting invited to an event or, you know, getting connected with someone whose career you want in the future? How have you benefited, gained a mentor? Yeah, love that. So maybe you got your network, I mean, you got your mentor because of Step Up or someone you knew, gained an internship one summer. That's awesome. Thank you for sharing, Holly. Got an internship, so seeing lots of opportunities that were granted to you because of social capital. Anyone else? Gained a mentor, gained knowledge, right? Let's not only think about opportunities, but gaining knowledge. For example, if you learned about a new career out there that you had no idea was even a job, that is beneficial, and that's building your social capital. Got to go to a leadership conference, gained a mentor from my dream job. That's amazing. Right. So seeing that you all already have seen the benefits of building on your social capital and having these networks that are so important for now and your future career. Okay, any other questions that you all have or further explanation to what social capital means before we move on? Received a reference. Yes, also that. I love that. Right. So if you have folks that you can ask for a reference for college, for your internship and whatnot, that is also super beneficial. All right. So now that we have hopefully a really good understanding of what social capital means, and again, along the way, if you have any questions, let me know or save them for our Q&A. So now let's talk about why these career connections are so important. We've already kind of seen, you know, you all, when you shared in the chat, ways that you've already benefited from them, but let's dive a little deeper on why these matter, right? Why we talk about social capital and career connections so much. When we did the icebreaker a few minutes ago, a lot of you selected folks, you know, like you selected Rihanna because, you know, that's a name you were familiar with, or you knew her work, or have, you know, benefited from her work because you really like her music, whatever it is. But sometimes it's really hard for us to maybe pick people that we're not as familiar with. I know some of you did, but oftentimes as humans, I'm going to speak again for myself, I'm an introvert. It's really easy for me to just gravitate towards folks I'm familiar with. So for example, if you're at a party or a networking event, you're going to gravitate towards your friends, right? So, but let's push ourselves to go beyond that and think about ways that that is hindering us from building our social capital to what it can be. So if we look at this image, we want to frame our conversation about the importance by this framework that is called My Ways of Student Success. And as you can see, it's a nice little visual here that see that you can kind of see the importance of why social capital is great to like build on itself, right? So we're going to start right at the bottom, right? The roots of it. So if we see at the bottom here, we see social support. And two ways that we think about social capital are bonding and bridging. And for this bottom one, this one is all about the family, right? The bonding one is emotional support, companionship, validation that you get from people that you already knew or are building building awareness of, right? And then bridging support is more the informational, right? The instrumental support that you're getting from these people. And it's important for you to have a variety of these folks in your life. And as you can see from the bonding, it's starting with Karen and adults, and then all the way to resources and connection when you're kind of bridging bridging those connections with folks. And as we're going up the trunk, we're seeing the developmental relationships. And this could be a relationship with your family, peers, colleagues, anyone that you're connected to. And it's through these relationships that you're discovering maybe who you are. Maybe you're talking to people that have a career that you really want in the future. You're talking with peers who are, you know, interested in a certain college or in a certain job, and you're learning about yourself through these connections. And it is helping us kind of shape who we are and shape our own lives when we are engaging and having folks contribute to us, right? And then if we go up to the branches, you see that those branches are the connections, right? All the little connections that we're making, from a LinkedIn connection to a connection with your mentor to a connection with someone in your neighborhood, a volunteering experience that you have. All these connections are so important, whether there's someone that you talk to once a year or someone that you talk to on a weekly basis, right? Because you are still fostering relationships and you're still fostering these connections that hopefully, you know, you can tap into whenever you need anything, whenever you need a resource, whenever you need someone to connect with. And if we see on the sides, we're seeing the well-being and resources that play an important role in our lives as well. One is the support that you need in times of well-being, right? If you ever need to talk to someone because you're having some issues, right? That kind of like enveloping support is there, but on also leveraging resources. Again, if you need knowledge on a certain career path, or if you are trying to get into an intro level job or an internship, that's kind of leveraging the resources of the folks that you're connected with. So hopefully that image made sense. Any questions about this framework around social capital and ways that kind of builds on itself? All right, so we're gonna continue talking about this concept, right? But I really wanna hone in the point that you have to build a really good foundation with the connections you have before you can ask for help, right? You don't want to just say, hi, my name is Maggie and I want to work in D&I. Like, can you get me a job? And this is your first conversation with someone, right? It's really important that you're fostering relationships, even if they're just going to be professional. So folks aren't feeling like, you know, you're essentially kind of using them for their resources. So that foundation is so important. And we're going to talk about tips about building LinkedIn contacts. That is definitely something that I have had to learn along the way, and I'm still learning, right? We're all a work in progress. So we're going to talk about tips in a little bit. So thank you for that question. But like I said, that foundational part is really important. And now we kind of want to like kind of deep dive into that and how we build connections, right? Now that we kind of have an understanding of what it is, why it's important. But before we move on, are there any questions about these first two parts that we talked about, right? What is social capital and why it's important before we move on to maybe potential barriers? And if you have a question that is related to something else that we're going to talk about, either like, you know, write it down or make sure you don't forget it so we can answer that for you. But thank you for putting that in the chat. All righty. So let's move on to barriers, right? So this part, we're going to talk about why you may not be making those connections or why it might be hard for you to build on your social capital. For the first one you see here is relying on yourself or only your family for support. This might be cultural, right? Like you might be a part of a community or a culture where asking for help is seen as a bad thing. I know, like I mentioned in my bio, I come from an immigrant household and my parents really instilled in us, like you work hard, you put your head down and don't ask for help because you're going to seem weak. You're going to seem like you don't know what you're doing. So it's really important for us to kind of like go against that notion and know that asking for help is a sign of strength, right? Because it's so hard to do so. So being able to ask for help is actually not a negative thing, right? And though some folks may get all the support that they need from their family, they might not be able to get as much variety of resources if you're only relying on your family network, right? It is very important to have that, right? I'm very fortunate also, speaking for myself, to have a very strong family connection and network with my family, if you want to say it like that. But we can't just kind of be insular, right? If we're only relying on ourselves, if we're only relying on our family for support, we're not really getting a variety of experiences, right? We're kind of closing ourselves off to doors that might not be open because our family doesn't have connections in those ways. Hope that makes sense. But if you're feeling like, okay, I don't know how to start, I don't even know where to begin. If I send someone a LinkedIn message, like, is that enough? But we can talk about more about that. And so, like I said, that's the first barrier, right? Relying on oneself and also relying only on family. And then our second barrier is feeling uncomfortable talking about personal stuff with anyone outside of family, right? So you might think like, oh, these people don't care about my problems. They don't care that I, you know, need an internship or need a job. But when you're in certain programs, like for example, Step Up, they're here to help you, right? When you go to networking opportunities, people are there to network. So they definitely want to help you. But again, it's about being intentional, how you're building those connections that really is going to set you apart. And then for example, again, it might be a cultural thing where you're just like, you don't share your problems outside of your family. Obviously, don't get to the nitty gritty when you're talking to a professional connection. But it's not a bad thing to say like, hey, I'm struggling to find a job, or I'm struggling to, you know, think about what career move I want to make next. People want to help, right? If you're talking to the right people, they're going to want to help. And if someone tells you no, they're not the right person. So it's okay for you to kind of put yourself out there. And again, I know I hate this phrase, but the worst thing that someone could say to you is no, right? So being prepared, mentally prepared, that they might not be the person to help you out. All right. So moving on to the next barrier is reluctance to ask for support because you're shy. Maybe you feel like, okay, I have social anxiety. I don't know how to walk into a group of people and introduce myself, right? Like you might be embarrassed of asking for help. So I want you to put like a plus sign if you've ever felt embarrassed or shy about walking up to someone and introducing yourself. I hope I see all the plus signs because I know I have. All right. So seeing Yep. So this is a very common human experience, right? We've all felt this level of like either shyness or embarrassment to just be like, you know, walk up to a stranger, right? Maria, I tend to do too much sometimes. Nothing's too much, right? So if you're being genuine to yourself and how you build connections, right, you might have to put on a hat of being an extrovert sometimes. I know I have to do that when I walk into a networking opportunity. I have to like give myself a pep talk in the mirror and just be like, these are just people, right? They're just people that you're talking about. They have similar human experiences to that I have. So being shy is not going to help me out. And, you know, like do it anyway, right? Like, and the phrase that my mom always says, like closed mouths don't get fed in Spanish. So if you're not asking someone for help, they don't know that you need it. So getting over this level that everyone has felt awkward, we've seen all the plus signs, right? Like everyone has felt a level of shyness or embarrassment just to be like, hey, can we connect? Or hey, like, your job sounds really cool. How did you get there? You have to understand that people love talking about themselves. If you remember that, it can get you a long way. Just asking them, like, how did you get to your career? How did you, how did you pick the college that you picked? You're going to open a lot of doors for yourself if you just become interested in having, like, someone share their story, right? And then, you know, another barrier that we have is when we think people don't have time for us. Again, if you're going to a networking experience, if you're being a part of SEPA, like people here want to help you. So you're not annoying anyone. Take away that mentality, right? Of like, oh, I'm going to annoy them if I send them in that email, or I'm going to annoy them if I like go up to them. If they don't have time to talk to you, if they're a good person, they'll be like, oh, like, I don't have a second right now, but like, come find me in X amount of minutes, right? And follow up with them. Or, hey, I don't have the capacity to like talk to you in the next couple of weeks, but hit me up in a month and then we might be able to like chat. Follow up with them, right? So again, the people that are not going to respond, you know, in the best way, maybe aren't people that you want to be connected with. So I'm telling you, most people definitely want to help. And the last barrier that we kind of want to talk about is a systemic, right? Systemic barriers that exist. You might have been in a community your whole life and never have left that community. Maybe you're thinking about going to college in the same community that you were born with. So that kind of, you know, gets some barriers for you because you're not able to kind of like leave where you live, but finding creative ways now that Zoom, you know, this networking in a virtual way has become super popular because we've had to, right? Leverage that. Leverage the fact that you can find people in different cities, maybe cities that you want to move to through LinkedIn, through other opportunities of those social networks. Really leverage those, because again, if we are just being insular, if we are just relying on our friends, our acquaintances, our family, we're limiting ourselves to the opportunities that are out there. So really take advantage of the fact that people want to help. People like talking about themselves, and you never know until you ask, right? You never know what you can gain from someone. All right, so now that we've discussed these barriers, any questions about these barriers in particular, or any kind of anecdotes or barriers that you don't see here on the screen or that we've talked about that you've experienced? What other barriers? And they might be the same ones that we see here, but you just want to kind of talk about your experience. That's cool too. Okay. And if you can't think about one right now, I definitely am going to give you the homework to think about that. Think about the barriers that you've experienced and then think of ways that we can strategize, right? Okay. So I'm seeing some folks putting things in the chat. Since I'm outspoken, my mentor limits what I say. Okay. Not being aware of opportunities where you can network, right? So you may not know the things that are existing out there, right? So definitely joining different groups on like social platforms about like careers that you want. There's everything's out there, right? So just not being afraid to Google. Like you can say like free workshops in my area, or free networking opportunities in my area. There's always things going on, right? And again, because now we're in a hybrid virtual world, there's so many things. So not being aware of opportunities that's so real, but making sure that we're using the resources that we have now to allow us to kind of see opportunities out there. Sophia, being shy. Yes, again, I feel that. And that's something that I struggle to this day, you know, as I've been out of college for almost a decade, and like having to go to networking opportunities is still so hard. But something that helps me sometimes is bringing a friend, right? If you bring a friend with you is something that's comfortable, but make sure I've done this where I bring a friend and we only talk to each other. And then I'm just like, that was a waste. But making sure that you and your friend are pushing each other to introduce yourselves together, right? Instead of just talking to each other. Cultural, definitely those barriers do exist, again, with like not wanting to ask for help, maybe that being instilled in you, or, you know, like only your family's supposed to know your problems, only your family's supposed to help you, right? So definitely something to, those barriers are very real. All right, so let's move on to talk about strategies, right? So now we talked about the things that are hard. Now let's talk about ways that we can build and maintain these networks, these connections. So here are some tips that we gained from a blog post that is online from Tammy Day. And the title of this blog post is Build Your Social Capital and Build Your Community. So these are some of the ones that we thought were the most helpful when thinking about where you all are at. So the first one, getting comfortable with introductions. So I like to practice my little elevator speech, and I'm sure that you might have worked on this already, but it's like a 30-second introduction of who you are. Obviously, you don't have time to give someone your life story, and that might not be applicable, right? So having like, if I'm doing like a job interview, the first question that they ask is, tell me about yourself. They're not asking for your entire biography, right? They want to know very key points. So obviously my name, where I've worked, why I'm passionate about that work, and where do I want to go, right? So thinking about your skills you've already gained, your experiences, and what you want to do with those skills in the future. So if you're interested in photography, for example, like, hi, I'm Maggie, and I've, you know, been a photographer, dabbled in photography for the past 5 years. It's something that I'm really passionate about, and I'm hoping to connect with people that have that interest as well. Whatever it is. I don't even know why I said photography. I've never done photography. But whatever your interests are, making sure that you are either making applicable to whatever space that you're in, or just knowing who you are and how you want to present yourself. So practicing that elevator speech might help with that, getting comfortable with introductions, because you already know what you're going to say, and you don't have to think about it on the spot. You can already have your, like, even if it sounds rehearsed, who cares? At least it's going to be cohesive, right? It's going to put across the point of who you are and why you want to connect with people. So getting comfortable with introductions, part of that is maybe building your elevator speech. We want to definitely take time to talk to people, and want to make sure that you also care about what they're talking about. Like I said at the beginning or a few minutes ago, people like talking about themselves. So being interested in what they're saying is important. Obviously, be authentic. People can read fakeness, but just making sure that you are being well-researched. For example, if you're connecting with someone for the first time and you know their name, look them up on LinkedIn. I do this all the time when I know sometimes on LinkedIn they can see who's seeing them, but who cares? So look them up on LinkedIn and make a common connection right there. If you see they went to a college that you want to go to, bring that up in your introduction. If you see that they have a really cool career that you want to be a part of, bring that up. They played tennis in college, and you know, you love playing tennis on the weekends, bring that up as part of your connection, because you know, you want to start kind of building those common threads, so they know, like, oh, that person is someone that I would be interested in talking about more, because you know, I relate to them. People will want to help people they relate to, right? So making those connections, doing your research beforehand if you're able to, so really allows them to see that you are thoughtful and that you are using your resources, right? Because if someone, you know, didn't tell you what they what they're all about, and you already know that feels good for them, they're like, oh, they look me up. So the other way that we want to maintain and build connections, like I said, just ask. The worst thing that someone can say to you is, no, I can't be your mentor. No, I don't know anyone in that field. No, but I may be able to find out, right? So just ask, be unapologetic about asking questions that, you know, you need help answering. Again, you don't know what you don't know. So asking is really important, and being curious about other people as well. Cultivating a reputation of showing up and getting things done. Again, making sure that when you say you're going to do something, do it. People want to work with others who are dependable. People want to work with others who they know are hardworking and have a really good work ethic. So building a reputation of when you say you're going to show up somewhere, you do it, right? When you say you're going to email them by Friday, email them by Friday. Obviously, you know, like having grace, things happen. But if you don't get to them by Friday, have a short explanation like, oh, I'm so sorry. Thank you for your patience, right? I'm getting back to you, whatever it is. But making sure that you're showing up when you say that you will is so important. Saying yes to opportunities, like you are here today, you said yes to this opportunity, so you're taking such a great step to building your social capital, building your network, right? So if you see anything that are happening that are free, that are accessible to you, just go to them, right? The worst thing that can happen is that you don't have the best time, but you can leave, you can exit the Zoom, whatever it is. So say yes to invitations that you're invited to, say yes to like opportunities like internships, experientships, like you are doing volunteer efforts in your community. How I got my first job is I was so lost in what I wanted to do. I just looked up a volunteer experience in Koreatown because that's where, you know, I was from. So I walked up and I was like, hey, I want to volunteer. I ended up talking to the right person and I ended up like building a connection with him. And without knowing, he was the director of the programs and he offered me the job on the spot. I was there to volunteer. I just put myself out there, right? So like, I didn't know that that was going to be the outcome, but you just never know who you're going to meet in that opportunity and what door that's going to open for you. Also being grateful, right? If folks are taking the time to connect with you, if folks are taking the time to build a relationship with you, expressing gratitude is so great, right? Because gratitude really kind of builds on bonds when you're saying, thank you so much for taking the time. Like, I'm so grateful for the connection we've made, because we want to build trust when we are building these connections as well, even if they're just professional, right? Extending gratitude is something that's so important. If you have a coffee networking thing with someone, sending them a thank you email, a thank you note afterwards, when you do your experienceship next week, at the end of it, just make sure that you are getting names and email addresses of folks that you connected with or want to connect with in the future. You know, send them an invite on LinkedIn, whatever it is. Returning the favor. Also really important. So when we looked at that tree, right, when we think about a family tree, for example, it kind of builds on itself. So returning the favor and being able to kind of have a reciprocal relationship is so important when it comes to social capital. You don't want to just be the one taking, right? You want to give back. Along that same line is inviting others to participate. Like I said, if you're feeling really nervous about going to a networking opportunity, bring a friend, bring an acquaintance, bring a classmate that, you know, you talked to that one time in math, whatever it is, you want to make sure that they're, you know, you're growing your network by inviting others as well, right? So that is also really important for us to do. And then lastly, if you are making a connection with anyone, keep them updated. I know I've had my mentor, I know Jamie knows my mentor, Roger, since I was in sixth grade, and he and I have lunch every time we can, right? Like I email him every few months to be like, hey, I'm like, this is what I'm doing with my life. This is what's happening. And not even just, I'm not asking for help. I'm just telling him like, this is what's going on in my life right now. And he appreciates that because it continues that, that relationship, right? So I'm not just talking to him every time I need help, right? We want to avoid that. We want to avoid just, making a connection where we are just contacting them when we need something, because that's going to make you not look the best, right? So that constant contact as much as you can, whether it's once a month with your mentor, every 6 months, whatever that relationship feels like, making sure that you are sharing updates, connecting with them outside of needing anything. All right. So I know I talked a lot for a while, so I want you to put any questions that you have in the chat as we are talking now, and I'm seeing that I'm over time. Oops, I'm sorry. Okay, so now is the time for you all to ask questions. I know there was a question in the chat about LinkedIn, so let me scroll up to it if I can find it. So it was about, do you have any tips to build a strong relationship with LinkedIn contacts? Thank you for that question. Okay, so as I'm answering this question, obviously listen, but then just think about other questions that you have. if you are building a connection through LinkedIn, I know it can be a little awkward, but instead of just connecting with them, you know, like you get the option of like connect with this person, send them a personalized message while you're connecting with them, right? Like, hey, I saw your profile and I think what you've been doing is really cool. I would love for us to talk about it. Just making a connection on LinkedIn doesn't mean you're making a true connection, right? Just because they are part of your 300 connections doesn't mean that you have a relationship with them, right? So being active about building that relationship, the key word is building, right? Don't just send them an invite and let that die, right? Making sure that, again, when you're introducing yourselves, you're saying why. If you're like a random person to them, they might want to know, like, well, why is this person connecting with me? Like, what possibly can they have wanted? All right, so we are actually going to dive a little deeper and go into breakout rooms. If you have any questions there, you might be able to ask them in your breakout rooms that when you are there. So please keep those questions in mind, and we're gonna like practice what we've been talking about.
All right. Thank you so much, Maggie. I hope everyone learned a lot from her presentation today. So let me ask this. Can everyone show in the chat from fist to five or on your screen from fist to five, how much do you understand about the importance of social capacity building now? Fist is, I don't understand anything about social capital building. It's like a zero. Or five, I just know so much now. I am so much more clued in on what it means and why it's important. All right. Looks like we're doing a good job. Thank you, Maggie. All right. So now let's continue the learning in our breakout sessions. In a moment, you will be put into breakout rooms where you'll get to spend more time directly with Step Up staff, with Maggie, to think about your own individual networks and who you'd like to have join your dream team of advisors and supporters. When you see the invitation to join a breakout room, go ahead and click on it. Okay, well, welcome back, everyone. We hope you enjoyed your breakout groups, where you had the opportunity to dive deeper into building your network and your dream team of advisors. Now we're gonna take some time to share out with the full group. You can share any reflections, aha, light bulb moments, or just any lingering questions you might have. So I guess we'll start with my group. Elaine so graciously offered to share on our behalf. So Elaine, you want to go ahead and share?
So the networking table was super helpful for me to identify like who, like which person goes into what category and like how can I find more people to fill in the other categories? Like hopefully I can find them throughout the experienceship. And a question that I asked Maggie that I feel like is like very beneficial is asking like if there's time or something, if the people at your host company need help. So like you warm up to them and then in the middle of the week, and if you're depending on your availability, like, oh, do you guys need any help with anything, to show like how eager you are and how hardworking you are. So that's what I took away from our breakout room.
Awesome. Thank you, Elaine. All right. Bree, do you want to have somebody from your group share?
Yes, please. So I nominated Espedi. So you could share on a takeaway or something you learned or what you enjoyed about the experience.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Espedi. My group consisted of Bree, Gloria, Caddy, and where are you? Sorry.
Holly.
I was looking for her. Yes. And we, well, something that I took away or that I got a better understanding of is how big our networks are already. I just writing it down, you know, or something that happened in our group was that a lot of us kept just writing down a lot of names. So I think it's interesting to see, you know, how many people we already know. And then while I was writing it down too, I was thinking about the people that I know and like the people that they know, and just how much of an opportunity that gives us to expand and get to know more people and again expand the network. And everyone had like something interesting to share about someone they know. So I really enjoyed the experience. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, Espedi. And that's so true. You know, your network has their own network that you can tap into. And oftentimes it's those weak ties, those like connections that are further out that help get you those internships and jobs and things like that. So don't discount those at all. All right, Elle, do you have somebody from your group?
I do. Monica's going to share on behalf of group three.
Hi, I'm Monica. And what I took away during the breakout room was that I realized that I have the right people in my life. I have a lot of connections, but I also know that I can expand my team.
Awesome. Thank you, Monica. All right, Stephanie.
Yes. So with group four, we had such a great discussion that we just got shut off before we even picked somebody. But we had Vanessa and Wendy and Nafisa, Isabella, Nicole. So if any of you want to share what we were talking about, feel free to jump in because we had a really great discussion, guys. Or I can pick somebody, volunteer or voluntold.
I just have one comment to make is that I didn't really realize like that I already had a lot of people in my network. And I think now it's just up to me to see how I utilize it and like make the most of it.
Absolutely. Like your family right there, letting your family know I'm looking for an internship. You never know, an uncle, aunt, cousin may have something for you. You just never know. All right, I think our last person is Chelsea. You have somebody from your group?
Yes, we have, of course, Pratika sharing. No one from the group wanted to save her voice. It's okay, we love hearing it, so go for it.
In our group, I'm not sure where the other two people are, but I see Shernay in it, but we had two other people in our group. I think that activity that we did with where everyone fits in, like after the whole dream team circle, we did like, you know, who's a resource agent. So I think it was like really insightful and like really introspective because you see like, in your life, who you actually have and who you need like for future connections. And so, at the end, like Ms. Chelsea had like a talk about, you know, as you meant, have made connections, then you can like start fitting the box and like organizing your things and make sure you have like enough connections. And then she also, one thing that stuck to me was that when she talked about like, you know, connections being like a process, it's not like an immediate thing and it takes time and patience, like in order to get the outcome that you're hoping for. And so I think that was like really, nice to hear because sometimes, you know, you don't get like an immediate reply back or something, but like you shouldn't be discouraged from making those connections. So I think that was like the biggest takeaway. And then also, is Miss Maggie still on the call? I had like a really quick question to ask. So I had to ask, like, you know, we were talking about like LinkedIn connections, but like, so if you don't have LinkedIn right now and you're doing it on email, then you know you said to like on LinkedIn you should send like a quick like message along with the connection. So if you're doing it on email, would you do the same thing? Because, you know, like LinkedIn is like more of like a professional platform, but like, would we do the same thing if we're just contacting or connecting with someone via email?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because that's basically what you would be doing on LinkedIn. It's messaging somebody. So you can, it's just a different way of doing it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. Well, we want to thank all of our Step Up staff for being here and sharing your time and insight with all of our experienceship participants. Special kudos to Maggie for helping lead us through today's amazing content. And we definitely want to thank all of you on today's call for always stepping up. We hope you found today's session helpful toward preparing for a successful next 2 weeks with your host company. And we hope that you are able to have a great time learning from our staff and each other. So now we have a few poll questions. All right. So if you want to just go ahead and respond to those poll questions, that will help us gauge what you're taking away from the session. All right. And I think the second one should be coming up soon. All right. So just a few announcements and reminders about next steps. Remember to respond to the email chain with your participant cohort, introducing yourself if you haven't already done that. Respond to all calendar invites from your host and communicate any schedule conflicts if needed. They need to know if you have a conflict, make sure you let them know ahead of time. Research the company. You haven't looked them up on Google, that's like just basics. You've got to do that. Write down any questions for mentors and do your self-care this weekend to show up rested and aware on Monday and have fun. All right. And this is just another quick plug for our mentorship app. I know many of you have already joined it, but if you haven't, go ahead and join it. You'll have the opportunity to continue to build your dream team because you'll have the opportunity to be matched with a mentor for support. You'll also have access to a ton of resources that can help you as you plan your steps to success. Just use the QR code there to sign up. I believe they've also put something in the chat for you as well. All right. So if you haven't connected with Step Up via social media yet, then I encourage you to do so. It'll help you stay updated on all the resources and opportunities we have available to teens and young adults. And it'll also share ways you can get more involved with us here at Step Up. So finally, if you have any questions about your upcoming experienceship placement or want to learn how to get more involved with us here at Step Up, then reach out to your points of contact listed there on the slide. And that's a wrap, folks. As always, thank you for choosing to be here with us today and being a part of Step Up. Your engagement always inspires us. Thank you.